We are in Romans chapter 6. And we have talked about this interesting transition that Paul is making. Paul has so effectively talked about the fact that we are saved by grace alone, that we are saved by a free gift, that it is a righteousness that has come from God, it is not a righteousness for God, that the demand that we are the ones that somehow have to make ourselves right with God is removed because God made us right through Jesus Christ. Right? We're all there? So then the logical mind begins to say, well, if that's the case, then why not sin? If His grace is always going to cover my sin because I'm redeemed by the blood of the cross and He died for my sins and He died for all humanity's sins and He died for the sins that I'm going to commit in the future, then does it make a difference? Why don't I just go on sinning that grace may increase? Why don't I just go on sinning to prove how powerful His grace is? Why do I have to make any distinction about my life? And Paul says, because you died to sin, and if you go back to it, you are resuscitating that which is dead. It's like returning back to the cancer that has been removed from you and saying, no, 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 I want it back. He's saying, you don't understand. God's grace so effectively has redeemed and saved you that He has created a new creature inside of you. And now you have a choice to live in that new creature or you have a choice to live in the old creature. And so He says that we should put to death the old and we should rise to the new. And that Satan, the world, and our flesh will constantly want us to resuscitate the old person in us, and we are supposed to be living in the new. And He says, you were baptized into Christ. When you were baptized into Christ, you were baptized into His death, so that the old person in you might die and the new person in you might rise. And so, I know we did these few verses, but if you go to verse 11, in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin but alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word count could also be consider. Consider yourself dead to sin but alive to God. Consider the fact that you have two natures. Remember always that you have two natures, and your job as a Christian is to kill the one and give life to the other. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. You got to start making some decisions about what you do while your life still walks on this earth. So although we are in this kingdom, we are not of it. But He's saying, don't miss the fact that this kingdom can have an effect on your life. The three enemies of your faith are Satan, the world, and your own sinful nature. Satan, the world, and your own sinful nature. That these three are constantly waging war with you. These three are constantly trying to resuscitate the old person and trying to get you to make those kind of commitments and those kinds of choices. So He says, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. Make choices as you're walking on this earth. Make choices about what you allow yourself, your eyes to see and your mind to think of. The magazines and the movies and the music and the things of this world that can affect the wrong side of you. Does that make sense? How many times have we told our children, I just don't want you to hang out with them. I don't want their bad influence on you. I want you to not do this, but do that, because you got to develop patterns of responsibility. You got to develop patterns of this or that or the other. We spent our whole adult lives raising our kids that way. And then when it comes to our own spiritual nature, we just throw everything again into the wind. What if we're supposed to live under the same kinds of disciplines spiritually? That we need to make choices so that we do not let sin reign in our mortal bodies. Do not offer the parts of your body, verse 13, do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to Him as instruments of righteousness. That every day you wake up with a choice. You and I wake up with a choice every single morning. Who are you going to serve? Are you going to serve the old man or the new man? Are you going to serve Satan, the world, and your sinful nature, or are you going to serve Christ? And it is a choice. And you make it every day. And you and I make it throughout every day. And so he's saying, be wise and be discerning about how this all works spiritually. So let's jump to verse 15. Verse 15, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? Again, he says, by no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, whether you are a slave to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you wholeheartedly obeyed the form of the teachings to which you were entrusted. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. I want to go back to verse 16. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey? What I find very interesting, that in the 20th and 21st century, one of the things that we have been so keenly aware is that everyone has a right to their own personality, discovering who they are. Now we even discover what our sex is. We are so self-absorbed. We are so self-defining that we're not going to let anyone define me. I'm going to define myself. I mean, it comes right out of a Broadway play. We're just waiting for someone to say, somehow I've defined myself. That unlike all of you who are following some system, like a ring in your nose being drugged somewhere, not me, I'm free. And what Paul is saying is, you're always a slave. The question is, to who? You are always a slave. Because I didn't create you to be supreme. I didn't create you. I created you in my image. You always serve somebody. The question is, who do you serve? Oh, no, I don't serve anyone. Ever hear someone talk like that? I'm my own free individual. Usually that person, well, you'll find them on drugs somewhere, or you'll find them in prison soon, because it just doesn't work. We are a slave always to something. And so we're either a slave to our sinful nature, we're either listening to Satan and his leadings, we're following the patterns of this world, or we're being conformed, our minds are being conformed to the image of Christ, and we are slaves to Him. Probably using the context of this verse, throughout our lives, we are either resuscitating the old man so that he can be a slave to Satan, the world, and our flesh, or we're raising the new man in us to be a slave to righteousness and a slave to Christ. But we are always serving something. Jesus says that you cannot have two masters. You can only have one. Notice, we always have a master. In every one of his parables, there's a tenant, a landowner, who gets tenants to work for him. All of his analogies, all of his parables are about him as the master hiring servants or slaves to work. One of the lies of the devil is that we're independent, that we could be self-defining. When in actuality we find out who we really are, the closer we get to God. Because we're created by him. The closer that we get to the Creator, the more we discover who he has made us to be. It's not that we're not unique. We're not all cookie cutters. You're not like me and I'm not like you. We are individually, beautifully, wonderfully unique. But we're still in service to the one who made us. Does that make sense? So in verse 19, he says, let me put this into human terms. Because you are weak in your natural selves, just as you used to offer the parts of your body in slavery to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer them in slavery to righteousness leading to holiness. Make the choice. You used to, when you were in the old man, when you were in that old person, you only knew one type of slavery and you gave yourself to it. But now that you have a new creature in you, now that you are born again, you now have a choice to which direction you're going to go every day. And not just every day, every moment. Right? All the world has to do is rear up its ugly head and you got to make a choice. Satan's going to rear up his ugly head and you got to make a choice. Someone's going to say something to you that you don't like and you got to make a choice. Someone's going to do something and you got to make a choice. It's about the fact that we have to mature ourselves in our discipline of our new creature. Verse 20, when you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. But what benefit did you reap at that time from the things you were not ashamed of? Those things result in death, but now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. And then an often quoted verse, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The wages of sin is death. The wage, we earn it. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. Notice he is moving towards holiness. What if you and I began to see the new creature in us as the very individual that will be perfected in heaven? We don't have to wait to get to heaven to begin to be that individual. See, too many of us think I'm just this blob of mess and I just can't wait till I die and go to heaven because then I'll be perfected. I'll be holy. I'll be perfect in his, you know. What if the kingdom of God is at hand right now and the new person in you is already the beginning of who God made you to be and who you will be in heaven? And what if the moment you're born again, that process begins? But just like any birth, you can't stay a baby. You gotta one day kind of push yourself off the blanket, you know, and start gaining some strength. And all of a sudden, before you know it, you've rolled over and your legs and arms are flipping around. And you're just like a baby beginning to learn how to function in that new person. And then the new person actually begins to walk, right? That's when it starts to get scary. For a real child and for a spiritual one. But then you get a cadence and all of a sudden you begin to walk and all of a sudden you get to run and all of a sudden you begin to see different and hear different. What if that new creature in us is the very beginning of the one who's going to be perfected in heaven. And so what he's saying is that we move towards holiness. Only the new person in you can move towards holiness. The old person cannot. The old person can only move towards death. The new person lives towards life. So all of a sudden, this new creature wakes up in the presence of God, and this new creature wakes up in faith with God, and this new creature wakes up in communication and prayer and the Word of God, and all of a sudden, this new creature, it dawns on this new creature who God's made him or her to be. So now that new creature goes out into the world and starts living different, looking different, being different, seeing different, because the kingdom of God is at hand, and they're beginning to live in that kingdom. When they go to work, it's just different. It's the same work, it's just different. The marriage relationship is different. The father-son, the child relationship is different. It's all different because I see differently. I used to see from this perspective, but now I see from this perspective. And before you know it, I'm maturing in the faith, and I'm moving further and further in this realm of holiness. What God has made me to be. Because in the beginning, he created Adam and Eve, and they were holy. And if Jesus Christ died and rose again to restore that in us, then why in the flip do we keep living this guy? Why do we keep resuscitating this guy? Why do we keep saying, hey, come on back to life, come on back to life? We got to die to this guy, so that we can move this direction. How pitied the Christian life. How pitied the Christian life who tarries and tarries on this side of life, going, oh my gosh, the world's crazy. I don't know what to do. I can't get myself out of this hole. I keep digging a hole but deeper and deeper. I don't know. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Can't wait till I go to heaven so I can get rid of all this. And God is saying, stop it. Get out of the hole. Stop it. Start walking with me. Start living with me. Maybe you'll get out of the hole and realize there's light. Maybe you'll realize there's dawn. Maybe you'll realize there's hope and peace and joy. What if Christians aren't experiencing these things because they're living over there? Because they're still bound and enslaved to the world and Satan and their flesh. They're treating Jesus like he's just a little add-on, like you add a little pepper or salt to your breakfast. Jesus is not just add-on. He's takeover. He's takeover. I made you born again. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you're born again. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven because you think you believe something. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven because you think you know something. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven because you do something. You can only enter the kingdom of heaven if you are born again. How come we try to keep trying to get in under different roads? Why do we keep trying to create different doors? Why do we keep trying to say, God, this is the way you got to accept me? And God's going, no. I get to choose. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Hey, Jesus, who's the greatest in the kingdom? Which one of us? We've left our jobs, we've left our homes, we're following you, we're willing to risk our lives for you. Which one of us is the greatest in your kingdom? And Jesus says to his own disciples, when he takes a little child in front of him, unless you change and become like one of these children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. He said that to his disciples. Not to a bunch of unbelievers. He said that to his disciples. Unless you start training your mind and your eyes and your ears to see from my kingdom's perspective, you will not see, hear, or think right. You just can't. So as long as you want to be a slave to your old man, then all you're going to do is think from his perspective. But if you start to live in the new man, you start to change perspectives. Does that make sense? In this kingdom, if I have 100 and I give you 10, I only have 90. In this kingdom, if I have 100 and I give you 10, God might let me live like I have 100 or 110. In this kingdom, if you only have a few fish and a few loaves of bread, you can only feed a few people. In this kingdom, if you have a few loaves of bread and fish and faith, it can be multiplied to feed thousands. In this kingdom, the dead die and never live again. In this kingdom, they rise again. In this kingdom, cancer kills people and they're done. In this kingdom, people can be healed from cancer. Which kingdom do you want to live in? Paul is saying in Romans chapter 6, why in the world would you keep going back to that? I used to live there, and Christ has set me free. I now see from a completely different perspective. I wake up every day knowing something different than what I used to know. I am no longer a slave to this. I am going to enslave myself to Jesus. Are you with me? Chapter 7. He uses an illustration of marriage. Do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to men who know the law, that the law has authority over man only as long as he lives? The law has authority only as long as you live. If he's dead, then the authority's grace. Law, grace. Law, gospel. For example, by law, a married woman is bound to her husband as long as he's alive. But if her husband dies, she's released from the law of marriage. If something dies, it changes everything. She's bound by the law to her spouse as long as the spouse is alive. But if the spouse dies, you're free. You're no longer bound. Verse 3, so then, if she marries another man while her husband is still alive, she's called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law, is not an adulteress, even though she marries another man. So, my brothers, you also died to the law through the body of Christ, that you might belong to another. Grab that phrase. Paul is saying you no longer belong there. You belong to another. Another has married you. How often is Jesus portrayed in the scriptures as a bridegroom? And we're the bride. You're no longer married to this world. You're no longer married to the sin and the flesh. You're no longer married here. But you are married to Jesus Christ. You are reconnected to your Creator and your Savior. Your relationship has been restored here. You are new, completely new. You are no longer bound. You are no longer bound to that because now you are bound to anew because you belong to another. You belong to another. You are His beloved. He loves you. He's called you by name. He's made you His child. You see what Paul's saying? It is so powerful. You belong to another, to him who has raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit to God. For when we were controlled by the what? When we were controlled by the sinful nature, The sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our bodies so that we bore fruit for death. But now, by dying to what once bound us, we have been released from the law so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. Notice he's getting more defined in his words. What he is saying is, you once were bound here because of your sinful nature. But because the Holy Spirit has done a work in us and redeemed and saved us, because he has done what he's done, he's created something new in us, and we are no longer bound there, but we're bound here because the love of Jesus has bound us and he has made us his. You were once in a relationship with what you should not be in a relationship with, but now you are in a relationship with the one you should be. You have a sinful nature that wants to rebind. You have a new nature in you, and he calls it, in verse 6, the new way of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but Spirit gives birth to Spirit. You were once born in the flesh, but now you are born in the Spirit. In that new birth, you have been bound to a new master. You have been bound to a new Savior. You have been married to something new. And this relationship now needs to be developed and worked out and figured out because it's going to complete you. But Paul is now beginning to talk about this old nature and this new nature, the sinful nature and the spiritual nature, the one that is led by Satan, the world, and my flesh, and the one that is led by the Spirit of God. I mean, have you ever thought sometimes like you're schizophrenic? It's because we are. Christians are certifiably schizophrenic. Because we're so aware of the old person in us that's battling and the new person in us that wants something different. Because both of them live inside of us and we got to kill one and raise the other. We become schizophrenic when we try to live both. When we try to bring some kind of complement to the two of them, they don't work. One will always die and one will always rise. You will either turn back towards death or you will turn towards life. You will either be a slave to sin or you'll be a slave to righteousness. You'll be married to the old person or you'll be married to Jesus Christ. You see it? You're awake, right? Okay. I mean, I knew we clocks did something yesterday, so I don't. Hey, honey, did you sleep last night? My wife is so funny. I gotta tell you, she is so funny. I thought there was a moment yesterday when she was gonna ask me to set my alarm for 4 o'clock to test whether the 7 things we had that were gonna wake us up in the morning were set right. Oh. It's so funny. All right. Verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? What he's beginning to say is the law, gospel. The law speaks to this guy and points out sin, right? You wouldn't know that you sinned unless someone told you it was a sin. Unless God pointed into your chest and said, you're not supposed to do that, how would you know not to do it? So he's saying, is the law sin? He says, certainly not. Indeed, I would not have known what sin was except through the law. For I would not have known what coveting really was if the law had not said, do not covet. But sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, produced in me every kind of covetous desire. For apart from the law, sin is dead. Once I was alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and died. I found that the very commandment that was intended to bring life actually brought death. For sin seized the opportunity afforded by the commandment, deceived me through the commandment, put me to death. So then, the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, righteous and good. So how does this work in our daily lives? You wake up in the morning. You kind of have this feel for how you'd like the day to go. So you go downstairs and maybe like me, it's quiet. You want to go make some cup of coffee. Dog's driving you insane because they want to eat. But at any rate, you get through that. And then all of a sudden, your mind begins to think. Ever been there? The question you have to ask yourself immediately is, which mind? They're both going to want to wake up. Because you are, until you die and go to heaven, schizophrenic. So all of a sudden, I'd begin to think about yesterday and the day before that and the day before that and the things that were done and the things that were said, and I begin to go, wait a minute, that person wasn't very nice to me. I feel offended. That person probably did that on purpose. Well, I'm not talking to that person ever again. Now your spouse comes down and you nip at them and they want to know what your problem is, and before you know it, it starts. It's because we subtly moved to the wrong side of who we are. Because we didn't take every thought captive. And we didn't stop at the very first thought and say, stop. Are you true? If you're not true, I'm dying to you. What if we woke up? We can't stop it. Both minds are going to start. Why do you think we pastors plead with you to begin with the Word? Because the Word feeds the new person. If you spend some time in the Proverbs or the Psalms or in the Gospels, you're going to be feeding the new creature in you. Your mind is going to focus on that which is godly right from the beginning. If you, before your feet hit the floor, if you pray with your mouth and you pray with your heart and your mind, you are already starting in the new man. How important it is that we start in the right place. What do they have before every NASCAR race? Prayer. But what do they have before the actual race? Qualifying heats. What does everybody want? They want the right spot. They want to start in the right spot. They want to start in the right spot. They know there's a disadvantage to start in the wrong spot. How about you? How about me? Waking up and saying, I want to make sure I start in the right spot. What if throughout the day we got to stop, pause, take it slow, grab the thought, decide whether it's true or false, let it in only if it feeds this man. If it's a lie, die to it. How much more successful and joy-filled and peaceful will our lives be if we begin to grab that authority? How many of us don't live our lives like we're the dog being wagged by the tail? What if you're supposed to be the dog wagging the tail? How many of us are living life like we're a ball in a pinball machine, just bouncing around uncontrollably and can't stop it, when in actuality, our fingers are supposed to be on the flippers? Yeah, there's going to be some craziness in there, but we can reset the direction. Who in the world would want you to think that you don't have authority? The enemy would want to tell you that you do not want to know this secret. He would tell you that you do not, he does not want you to know the secret of Romans 6, 7, and 8. Because if you know the secret of Romans 6, 7, and 8, it changes everything. Because he's teaching us how to live on this side of life. And he's teaching us why. And he's teaching us how. And how powerful God is to feed this new person. How faithful he is to join us on this side. Because he's a groom to a bride. He loves us. He's not over on this side with a hoop saying, well, jump a little higher, jump a little higher. He's on this side going, welcome him. Welcome. Let's do this thing. Let's go out and do this thing. Thanks for starting your day with me. Walk with me now. When Kimberly and I were raising seven kids and putting them through college, the one thing we said was we prayed that the Lord would, towards the ends of our lives, let us live some type of a life where we could do this whole thing together. And God's been faithful. Our whole lives, we were separated. I'm going to Allied Metals. She's going this direction. I'm going that direction. She's going this direction. But both of us had a heart for ministry, trusting that God would do something. My point is, what if that is a picture of what God wants? He wants us all. He's already established. I'm here. Come this direction. Start your day here, and let's go. And what about throughout the day when we start to deviate? He says, hold on, hold on. Think, grab it, come back here, let's go. And what if by that discipline, by learning how to operate there, we actually live on this side more than we live on that side? Like if it's 80-20, could it be 80-20? Sure. But it takes some work. It takes some work. You have to train the new person in you. You have to train your mind, transform your mind and heart. You got to learn how to live this over here. And that's the whole journey that Jesus took with his disciples. This whole Life of Jesus sermon series that we're involved in, it's a snapshot of their training. Guys, you can't see it from this perspective. You must see it from this perspective. And sometimes, when we're here, that darn Jesus, he has this tendency to want to stretch us. Jesus, if that's you, if that's really you out there, if that's really you out there walking on the water, call me out. I want to come out there with you. Come. He's walking on water. I mean, we always talk about the fact that he sunk. I get it. But what about the fact that he took the, he trusted. He moved. There was a day where he was out of the boat and the other disciples were in the boat and he was standing on water just like Jesus was. That just like Jesus healed people, maybe someone who comes up here for prayer or back there for prayer might get healed. Maybe someone whose life is going a 180 might have their life changed and go a 180 because of the gospel preached here, or the sharing of faith that you have at work, or the love that you have for someone, or just simply your compassion. See, there is a force that does not want us to live on this side of our lives, because we can change everything. We can change everything. Just one of the parables that we're going to look at in the sermon today is the parable of the sower. So often we hear this phrase, but we forget its emphasis. And some seed fell upon the good ground, and it yielded 30, 60, 100 times what was sown. What? Apple seed, ground, tree. One tree, one seed. Corn, seed, one stalk. You, good ground, multiplied 30, 60, or 100. What was sown? How's that possible? Because in this kingdom, you coming to faith and living your life in Jesus Christ and living in this new man, throughout your life, you will multiply the kingdom just because of who you are. The Holy Spirit will work in and through you, and you will then produce fruits. You will then gain and create fellow Christians. You will have an impact on the kingdom, so that the benefit or the fruit is, though, although God put one seed in the ground, he got 100% out of it, 100 times what was sown. There is an enemy that does not want you to believe that's possible. There is an enemy that wants you to live in the math of 1 = 1 and how important is 1. What's the difference? What does it matter? I've said this in Bible class, and I'll close with this. Billy Graham was once asked, "How did it all begin for you?" You have touched millions and millions of people around the world. You are singularly responsible for the conversion of millions of people in the country or in the world. How did it begin? And he begins to tell the story of a 75-year-old faithful Sunday school teacher who just faithfully just kept doing what he or she was doing. And out of that class, Billy Graham understood, accepted, believed, and began to move. Can one person make a difference? I would say that Sunday school teacher made a big difference. That Sunday school teacher may have never, ever, 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 probably didn't ever preach a sermon, and certainly did not know that the years that he was teaching Sunday school to Billy Graham, that he was teaching the greatest evangelist of the 20th century. But it was true. There's no way in the world that a teacher at Lutheran East knew that when he was teaching this kid who knew nothing about the Bible and nothing about God, that one day he would start a ministry called Firmly Rooted Ministries, and that it would touch hundreds of people, thousands, if you talk about websites and sermons and Bible studies. He was just teaching. He was just doing his job. Thirty, sixty, 100 times more than what was sown. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for the power of your word. Thank you for the power of the Spirit. Thank you for the new person in us. And Father, now unite the three. May we live in a bond of marriage with you, Lord Jesus, and the Holy Spirit that connects the two of us. May we learn to live in this marriage. May we learn to dance and walk in this marriage. May we learn to see and live and breathe in this marriage. May teach us, Lord. May every day be a growth process in dying to the old and rising to the new. Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.